Welcome to Bournemouth Skeptics in the Pub. So this is a volunteer-run group for the promotion of science, reason and critical thinking. We meet here at the Brunswick on the second Wednesday of every month. We do ask, so it's a £3 suggested donation if you can to help us with running these events. There's a box at the door back there, so if you didn't see that on the way in, make sure you see that on the way out. So the format for this evening, we'll have our presentation from our speaker. That'll go on for about 45-50 minutes, depending on how overrun he is. We'll have a 15-20 minute drinks break, you can top up your glasses, and then we'll come back for a question and answer session. We'll try and finish around 9:30, but as you probably all know, we don't always hit that particular time. So, this evening, our speaker, he is a freelance mathematical enrichment speaker. He is, apparently this is a real thing, he is the Guild of Jesters, Jester of Bournemouth. Perhaps you can explain that at some point. And the former champion of the popular TV show Countdown. So please give a very warm welcome to Barney Maunder-Taylor.
Lovely introduction, Simon. Well, I have to take exception with some of the things that you wrote on the sort of synopsis of what was going on in this evening's talk. I think the title of the talk was How to Be a Mathematical Charlatan or something. That's not right. And you didn't even get my name right either. So apologies for the mistake. My name is actually El Magnifico. And I'm not a mathematical charlatan at all. I have genuine superpowers. I have the power of being a human calculator. I also dabble in a little bit of mind control and a little bit of mind reading as well. I'm a product of my father, who was a stage hypnotist, and my mother, who was a Guatemalan snake charmer. Some people say, I'm not. Some people say they need to account for these powers. Obviously, we're former skeptics in the pub. I don't expect you to take my word for it. So I've prepared a couple of crude little demonstrations of my super mind reading abilities. So to start off with, I am going to read somebody's mind. So at this point, I'll ask you all please to project your thoughts from your mind to my mind. And I'm going to try and establish some sort of strong connection with one of you mentally, whose mind I can peer straight into. So I'm looking around the room, I feel the vibe. Oh, I'm getting very strong vibes from over here. Only because I know this is terrified I was going to ask her. But in fact, I'm getting even stronger vibes from this chap here, whose name is
Phil.
Can we have a round of applause for Phil, who's going to give us a stand right there and do what you were doing, peer into my eyes. I can already tell exactly what you're thinking. You're thinking, why did he have to pick me? So over here we have some numbers arranged in a grid. In a moment I'm going to ask you to choose some of these numbers. But first of all, based on my ability to read your mind, I'm going to try and predict which numbers you are going to choose here. So I've got some big comedy numbers here. Okay, so for Phil, I think... Yeah, definitely that one. And just tell me that again. I think I'm going to go for that one there as well. So my prediction is now locked in, I can't change it. Phil, can you pick up the red pen, please? I'm going to come over here so I can't influence you with my mind control. In the top row, you've got four numbers, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Could you please choose one of them and just ring it, just circle it? 1, 2, 3, or 4, it doesn't matter which one, I already know which one you chose. So the other three that you did not choose from the top row, could you just strike them out with a line? Just cross them out. Okay. And also, whichever number you circled, could you also cross out the other numbers in that column? So the numbers directly underneath the one that you just circled. Okay, so we're moving down to the second row now. There should just be three numbers left. Could you cross one of them out? Brilliant. Choose any one of them. It doesn't matter which one. I already know which one you're going to choose. Okay. Circle it. Cross the other two out. We don't want them. And also the one you just circled. Could you cross out the other two numbers in that column, please? So underneath the one that you just circled. Is this all going good?
Yes.
It's all going great. Okay. So moving down to the third row, there are two numbers left. Circle one of them, please, Phil. Cross the other one out. Again, hiding it so I can't see. I've already made that prediction. And also, could you cross out the other one in the column of the one that you just circled? Yep, so all good. And then moving down to the fourth row, there should just be one number left. Circle that, please. Thanks, Phil. Okay, so Phil's now chosen four numbers, which he thinks he did completely at random. I did do a little bit of mind control there with the mind reading. Can you now please add those four numbers up? You can all do this as well to check if he does it right. When you've added your four chosen numbers up, can you put the total in big, big numbers at the top? Yep, the total. Okay, that's great. Yep. Right, yep. So based on Phil's mind and the vibes I was getting from him, I have to try and predict which ones he's going to choose. Phil was able to choose any four numbers he wanted. Now, based on my reading of Phil's mind, I was pretty sure he was going to have a number adding up to 30-something. Was it 30-something?
Yeah.
It was the unit digit was a little bit harder, but I had a feeling it might be 30. So there you go, and I can already sense what you're thinking. You're thinking anecdotal evidence, sample size of one. There's no mind reading at all. Or perhaps if you're a particularly cynical skeptic, you may even think, well, look, he's probably done this 20 times, it's probably the first time it's worked. If I do it with enough skeptics, it's bound to go right eventually, and at least one group of skeptics will be convinced I have psychic abilities. But I don't expect you to take my word for it just from that one proof demonstration. So I'm now going to read your mind. And your mind. If I'm going to read everyone's minds here. I'm going to do mind reading for everyone simultaneously. So you can all play along here. I'd like each of you please to think of a number between 2 and 10. Not 5. Just a normal whole number. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You've got your number. Okay, that's a very simple bit of maths for you to do. Can you please multiply your chosen number by 10? Okay. Right, now it's going to be slightly tricky bit. I'd now like you to subtract your starting number, the number that you started with at the beginning. Okay, so you've got your number between 2 and 10, you times it by 10, you subtracted your starting number. Okay, you should now have a two-digit number. Could you please add those two digits together? Okay. Subtract 5. Okay. I'd now like you to turn your number into a letter. So if your number is 1, that's A. If your number is 2, that's B. 3 is C, and so on. So, has everyone got a letter? Everyone a letter? Brilliant, okay. Could you please think of a country beginning with that letter? Okay. Got a country beginning with that letter? Right, take the second letter of that country, please. And I'd now like you to think of an animal beginning with that letter. Okay? But that's absurd, there are no elephants in Denmark. We have a pact, no heckling until the second half. Okay, hands up if you think I'm a genius. Oh, on the other hand, hands up if you think I'm a dirty, rotten sheet, a charlatan, a blackguard, a bound and a cad. Deceitful, yes, and dishonest, yes. I am in fact, my name is not El Magnifico, I am a charlatan, my name is Barney Maunder-Taylor. So a couple of very crude tricks to start me. Of course I can't read minds, but I do know a little bit about numbers and a bit about patterns. So I'm just going to demonstrate, show you all how that first trick worked. It's a really nice fun one, very easy to do around the Christmas table on your family. So we had a group of 60 numbers, I asked Phil to choose 4 of them. Now, let's suppose that Phil had chosen these four here, 1, 5, 9 and 13. Of course, the way I asked him to choose the numbers, he wasn't able to choose those four. He had to choose one from each column. But let's suppose that he had chosen those four. Well, they would add up to, 13, 10, 23, 28? Yeah. However, I asked Phil to make sure that one of them was from each column. So let's take one of those numbers. It doesn't matter which one. I'm going to take the one, and let's just move it over to the second column. and see what effect that has. Well, of course, that has one to the 20. We're now up to 29. And one of the numbers had to come from the third column. So let's move the 9 over. It doesn't matter which one, I'll move the 9 over. That adds another 2 to the total. And one of them had to come from the fourth column. It doesn't matter which, I'll move the 5 over, adding another 3 to the total. So although I had no idea what numbers Phil was going to choose, I couldn't be confident that they were always going to add up to 34. So nice simple trick, do try that one around the Christmas table. It's really good fun, nice and easy. Then we came to the elephants in Denmark. I love that trick because it's just so silly. It really is. This is a nice, easy, self-working trick again. It relies on a particular property of the 9 times table. So here's the 9 times table. Let's just focus on the answers. 9, 18, 27, etc. So what we find is if you take these two digits and add them together, 1 and 8 make 9. Similarly, 2 and 7 make 9. 3 and 6 make 9. 4 and 5 make 9. And all the answers to the 9 times table, if you add the two digits together, we find that the digit sum is always 9. So this gives me a nice, easy way of forcing you to choose a particular number. I ask you to take a number between 2 and 10. I ask you to take 10 lots of it and then subtract 1 lot of it. Well, that's just a fancy way of getting you to multiply by 9. So by the time you've done that, I knew you had one of these numbers. Add them together, I knew you had 9. So I could force you to, well, I said subtract 5 to get down to 4. That means your country's probably going to be Denmark, unless you are Mike, in which case, yeah, Democratic Republic of Congo, etc. There are too many animals beginning with these, so there you go. Okay, so that concludes the first part of the talk, which is all about what I'm going to call self-working tricks. I didn't really have to do anything. I didn't even have to turn up, to be honest. I could have just made an audio file and kind of played that. So I'm going to move on now to some semi-self-working tricks. These are tricks where I do have to do something, just not very much. So this is tricks like the 10 times table. If I take 10 times 78, well, some kids at primary school are really impressed when I'm very easily able to do this. But of course, you all know the trick, which is 0 on the end. And then we have the 11 times table as well. It's semi-self-working. I do have to do something, but the pattern is really, really easy. So I've now prepared a little medley of mental multiplication for you. So we're going to have a look at
97 and 91.
97 times by 91. Okay, we have 3, 9, 12. 8,827, was it?
Yeah.
Oh, that is great. Let's do one more. Can I have a number in the 90s?
Yep, 91.
91 multiplied by Lynn? 91 times by 97. Did we just have that?
Oh, it's the other way around, though.
So we got, what was it? It was 91 times by 98. 91 times by 98, that's 2, 9, 11. 8,918?
Yes.
Brilliant. Let's have a couple of numbers in their teens to multiply. Mike, can you give me a number in their teens?
18.
18? And another one?
12.
18 times 12 is 216? Yeah. Is that right? Yeah. And well, let's have another one of those. A number, we're going to come all the way to the back. Can I have a number in the teens, please?
15
multiplied by?
16.
15 times by 16 is 240?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's a few tricks that, if you're interested, you can buy the book on Vetted Maths. They're quite good fun. But I've prepared a slightly more preposterous trick as well. This one is a little bit absurd. It uses some of the ideas that we've had so far, like the digit sum and the 11 times table, this, that, and the other. So, who can I choose who looks trustful? I'm going to come all the way over here to someone who's got a phone. You've actually got a calculator with you. Oh, you're the man. What's your name?
David.
He's forgotten. David. Okay, give him a round of applause for David. You're 18, right? Of course you are, yeah. Okay, so here's a blackboard and a piece of chalk. David, I would like you to choose a 3-digit number to write on the blackboard, please.
So you have to press quite hard on the frame of that black wall, which is only a three-digit number, like 357 or something. A three-digit number. And then when you've written it, I'd like to place the blackboard upside down on the floor, so make sure I can't see it. Okay. Right, have you got any calculator?
Yeah.
You want a calculator? Okay. So can you please type in that three-digit number that you just chose? Oh, you remember it, good. Okay. And can you please multiply it by 7? Great. Can you now show what's written on the calculator to someone near you who's got a calculator? Who near David's got a calculator? John, you've got a calculator. Can you show John your what's written on the calculator? Okay. John, could you type that number into your calculator, please? Right, and can you multiply by 11 and then press equals? Okay, and can you please show that to someone sitting nearby you who's got a calculator? So we've got Phil on the end, she's got a calculator. Can you type that number into your calculator, please, Phil? And multiply it by 13? Right, okay, so in a moment I'm going to ask you to show me what's on your display. And I'm going to try and undo what you just did, because we've just established that the 7 times table has a pattern, so does the 11 times table, and so does the 13. So if you can multiply by those, presumably I can pretty quickly divide by those and say that David's number was 726. Yeah, it was 726, yay! Yeah. Yeah. Around here know exactly how that trick works. You can all go home and do that trick, right? Okay, so if you'd like to be able to perform that trick for your family at the Christmas table, you choose a three-digit number, you times by 7, you times by 11, you times by 13, at a glance, you then should be able to work backwards to figure out what the original three-digit number is. They've just figured it in the back row over there as well. Try it out! You'll very quickly figure out how that one works. Okay, another preposterous trick. Right, what are we going to do? Okay, so I need a couple of people who are fairly comfortable using their calculators. Who's been using their calculator and is fairly happy with what they're doing? I'm going to choose, we've got a cluster of mathematics. Is there someone at the back who's got a calculator? Who I haven't picked on yet. You don't have to come up to the front and do anything. Actually, the chap in the corner, you've got a calculator. What's your name?
Sean.
Sean. Are you happy using the calculator?
Yes.
Brilliant. I would like you, please, to choose any two-digit number and type it into the calculator. Right. If anyone else would like to play along, we could do this simultaneously with several people. So you can all choose a two-digit number. Sean, can you add either 17 or 53? I don't mind which one you choose. Okay? Double it. So after each step, you have to press equals, by the way. Yeah, so times by 2 and then press equals. So we've got a few people doing this, I think. If you are right-handed, could you add 32? If you're left-handed, add 58. And I'm just checking what hand you use. Right. Can you please add your age as well? And I'm going to examine the body language here. I will be able to tell if you're lying. Because I'm not lying. Okay. Yeah. What day is it today? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. It's the third day. Multiply by 3, please. Okay. And press equals. Could you now please add either 57 or 69, your choice. Equals. Times by 3 again, because it's Wednesday. Times by 3. And press equals, okay? And then finally, if you would like to, you may add 117. But that's an optional step, you don't have to do that. Right, so that is the end of that. Sure. You've got quite a large number there. What is it? 5 digits?
4.
4 digits. Okay. I'd like you to read out any 3 of the digits, but miss out the other one. Okay, so if your fill number is 1, 2, 3, 4, you could say 4, 1, 2 or something. So can you now please tell me three of the digits and miss out the fourth? What three of the digits?
2, 4, 0.
2, 4, 0. Well, you missed out three then. Hey! You worked! Come on, even! And should we grab David? Were you playing along?
I was, but I'm not sure if I did it right, but anyway.
Oh, well, in that case, so I think I'll just take that. That's 1 out of 1. Brilliant. Thank you. I love that one just because it's silly. It's Lewis Carroll's. Right, okay, so how are we doing? There's a bit more algebra about how to multiply two numbers in the 90s because I know following us. But that's Vedic maths for you. The pattern is quite simple. But yeah, by the book, it's loads of fun. Right, so I'm going to take a bit of a break from the tricks now because I wanted to, as well as debunking tricks that look impressive but are quite easy, I did also want to pay homage to genuine human calculators because there are people who are genuinely gifted in this and can do terrific things. And I think it's nice to celebrate some of them. I read once that the most closed-minded person you will ever meet is a sceptic. And sometimes I think we can be guilty of that a little bit. So let's celebrate people who are good at their craft as well. Not me, I'm a charlatan, but there are good people out there. So this part of the talk, I'm going to put up a few celebrities, and I genuinely would like your help to try and decide if these people are charlatans or not. Just get entertained. So, I had a few ideas for what I could call this. Friend or foe? Chum or cheat? It's got a bit of a ring to it. What I really want to know is, these people, are they genuinely doing what they say they're doing, or are they being deceitful? So, what do you think? Hogwash or hogwash? It sounds good, but it doesn't quite say what I'm trying to do. So I've gone for Honest Joe or Charlatan. So we've got a few people coming up on the screen. In each case, I would really like and appreciate your help in deciding whether they are Honest Joes or charlatans. So let's be the first one. It's this cheeky chappy. Does anyone not know who this is? Because if you don't, you must be really young. Congratulations. Because this guy is a megastar. We all know who this is, right? Paul Daniels. I suspect that many of you, like me, were glued to your TV sets in the 80s, I think, when Paul Daniels used to do his magic show every Friday or Saturday, something like this. And he would do a magical gesture with his hands, he'd incant some magic words, and he was absolutely, would look him in the eye and say, oh yes, yes, that's magic, that's actual real magic. But with a bit of a wink at the camera, and we, the audience, played along, we all knew it was just entertainment, not magic, but if you allow yourself to believe that you've just seen some genuine magic, it can be quite entertaining. Personally, I don't think he was doing anything dishonest. I think he's an entertainer. So, what do you think? Honest Joe or Charlatan? Honest Joe. Great, yeah. Okay, so now we have Penn and Teller. Interesting duo, these guys. They're famous for debunking magic tricks and showing you how some of their magic tricks are done. But again, they're magicians. They have named James Randi as being instrumental in getting them started. That's not Santa Claus, by the way. That chap's James Randi, who seems to keep coming up in conversation in our skeptics meets. He's a great skeptic. All of these people are famous for debunking psychics. And Penn and Teller have a TV show called Bullshit. So, I don't know, but there again, they do claim to do magic. So, what do we think? Honest Joes or charlatans? Honest Joes, I agree. Okay. The next person is another stalwart of the skeptics movement. Another chap who we all admire enormously because he has come up in conversation several times. So, let's pay our respects, please, to the wonderful... Yuri Geller. Was that a boo? So, Yuri Geller is a psychic. He can do, what is it, telekinesis, where he just focuses on something and with the power of his mind makes things move. He can read your thoughts, he's psychic, and of course he's a bender. He can bend spoons. He was famously debunked on TV by James Randi. who invited him on to do one of his demonstrations and basically sabotaged it. He figured out how Uri Geller was doing this and made sure that it wasn't going to work. But Uri Geller has always been absolutely adamant that he really is a psychic and he really is doing the things he claims to. Now, I'm not in the business of calling anyone except for myself a charlatan, but I don't know, is he being deceitful or is he just a very good entertainer? Right. You decide, honest job or charlatan?
Charlatan.
Oh, lots of charlatans there. Okay, right. Now it's going to get tricky. Derren Brown. Yeah, a new brand of a magician, isn't he? So when he burst onto the scene, magic became different. It wasn't the squeaky, that's the way to do it, sort of Paul Daniels cheesy style anymore. This is psychological magic. And he does often say at the start of his show, he says, by the way, I'm not really reading your mind. I'm just picking up suggestions to you to try and steer you this way or that way. But I suspect that actually he's just doing magic tricks. I'm not sure. Or maybe he's reading body language. What do we think about this guy? Honest Joe or charlatan?
Honest Joe.
No.
All my time to devise a fight in row three. And how about these guys? So on the right we have Harry Houdini, escapologist. And on the left we have Derren Brown, of course, yeah, who names Harry Houdini as a great source of inspiration. Now both of these guys are great entertainers. They are talented escapologists, they really can pick locks and escape from straitjackets. But they kind of take it a little bit further. Both of them have done buried alive stunts. So Harry Houdini was the first to get buried alive. He famously, well, it kind of went a bit wrong, and he emerged from the earth scraping to get out, and by all accounts he had a bit of a panic attack. It didn't end too well. He had another go later. David Blaine, he's done a buried alive stunt, and lots of other sort of stunts where he has to keep at it a long time. He stayed in a plexiglass glass box for 40-something days, was it? In London, for everyone to view, no food or no water. He stayed balancing on a huge tower for days on end. But what I really like, and this one's got to be true because it's Guinness ratified, is he used to hold the world record for holding your breath. He can hold his breath for an astonishing amount of time. Anyone know how long David Blaine can hold his breath for? And this is Guinness ratified, it's a general world record.
Have
a guess.
9 minutes.
9 minutes. A little bit more, actually. 17 minutes.
Wow.
Now, you can check it out. This is Guinness ratified, it's a general world record. Now, I'm really torn here, because I can't hold my breath for 17 minutes. The category is static apnea, and the deal is that you're allowed to breathe pure oxygen for 20 minutes or so before the attempt starts to fully oxygenate your blood, so you're saturated with oxygen and you can hold your breath for a lot longer than normal. I'd be interested to hear from anyone with a medical background to whether they think there is anything in that. But I'm torn. The fact that it's Guinness ratified lends it a slight veneer of respectability, but I also know he's a magician, so I wouldn't put it past him to cheat. I really don't know what I think. The world record's been broken several times since. It's now up to 20-something minutes. I don't know. David Blaine, honest Joe or charlatan? Is he really doing the things he says he's doing, or is he just an entertainer? Okay, I don't really know. Okay, so I'm going to finish off with a couple of great people. This guy's one of my idols, Art Benjamin. He is a genuine mathemagician. He is the maths robot, a human calculator. And he also names James Randi as being very influential on his early career. He appeared in a TV show in his early career called Exploring Psychic Powers Live, co-hosted by our old friend Uri Geller.
Yeah.
And he's also co-authored several books, one of which I've got here, The Secrets of Mental Math, with a chap called Michael Sherman. Anyone know Michael Sherman? Yeah, a few of the hardcore skeptics do. He was one of the founding members of the skeptics movement. So it's thanks to Art and Michael and a few other people that we're here tonight enjoying each other's company and a bit of talk. So his favourite trick that he does, the one that I really like, is he will multiply any two-digit number. Just like that. You want 58 times 33, bam, and look straight in the eye and give it to you straight out. The book describes how he does it. It's really a collection of techniques that he's very well practiced in. I love it, personally. Love it. And finally, does everyone know who this is? I'm talking about this one over here, not this one over here. Of course it's Rachel's right.
Yeah.
The Princess of Countdown. So I was on Countdown a few years ago. I won!
Yay!
And then I lost. So I was champion of Countdown for about half an hour. and people often say, is she really doing those number songs as quickly as she says she is? Or is someone whispering in an earpiece or something? Well, I can tell you categorically, she's really doing it. There's no earpiece. She puts her numbers up, someone hands her a clipboard, she does some scribbles, and she has the same 30 seconds as everyone else. So here's an example of a sort of puzzle. You get your six numbers here, and you've got to add, subtract, multiply, or divide to make that target number there. So, how are we doing for time? Are we doing okay? Should we have a go? Let's have a go! Okay, so I'm going to put six numbers up here. I'm going to give you a target number, and your 30 seconds starts now. What's that target? It can't be that hard, can it? Who's got the answer? Oh, sure, nice one! You think so?
I'm not worried now.
I'm mightily impressed, because Rachel got it. I didn't, the contestants didn't, but Rachel got it. Do you want to have a go?
11 times 15 minus 4.
11? So 9 plus 2 is 11, is that you got the 11? Mm. And then 7 plus 8 is 15.
Yeah.
And you multiply them together, you get 165.
Yeah.
And then you subtract the 4. Oh, yes! Okay, so here's how Rachel did it. Rachel says 8 times 2 is 16. And then she added the... Well, let me check this. She added the 9 and subtracted the 2. And that got 23. Okay, and then she got... I don't know what we're seeing here. Fancy that. And then you just times it by 7. And that's the answer. 161. And as she said this, she said, it's the product of two primes. As if that explained everything. So these are two numbers. I've got another example, which I'm not going to do, but again, a very difficult one that neither of the contestants got. And Rachel came up with the answer. And at the end, it turned out to be, what was it? It was 47 times 19. And she said, everybody loves a product of two primes. So I guess the secret is, learn your times tables of the prime numbers. So yeah, definitely thumbs up for Rachel Riley. I would definitely say that she's a genuine mathematician. Right, so no talk about mathematical tricks would be complete without looking at magic squares. So I'm going to talk very quickly about magic squares and then we're going to try and generate one up here. So a magic square, very simply, is a square array of numbers like this, so that every row and every column has the same total. Here we've got every total is 15, and you can check the columns, they're up to 15. Bonus points if you can get the diagonals to work as well, this one adds to 16. So there's lots of fun things you can do with magic squares. Some of them good tricks to do around the Christmas table. But you'll appreciate them a lot more and be able to do a lot more with them if you understand a bit of the background. So I'm just going to talk about Latin squares first of all. Imagine you're a farmer. Here's a field, and you're going to grow a particular type of crop. In our first year, we've got four different seed varieties, so we're going to plant a little of each to see which seed variety does the best. On the basis of that, in subsequent years, we'll know where to get our seeds from. So, what are we going to do with our four seeds? Well, I'm going to call them blue, pink, green, and yellow. We could just divide into four and plant blue seed there, the yellow there, the green there, the pink there. But if this seed does the best, how do we know it's because of the seed and not because the soil conditions are best there?
We don't.
Or exactly. Or maybe this quarter gets more sun, something like that. So what we do is we divide into 16 squares and we allocate four squares to each of the seed varieties in such a way that they're completely muddled up. I might choose to put the blue seeds here. So the top isn't represented any more than the bottom, the left isn't overrepresented more than the right, some of it's in the middle, some of it's around the edges, and if the blue seed produces the best results, we can be reasonably confident it's because of the seed, not because of the positioning. So here's why I put the other seeds, and this is a Latin square because there are four symbols, each of which is represented once in every row and once in every column. So a completed Sudoku puzzle is a Latin square because each of the numbers will be once in every row, once in every column. Right, now let's move on to the magic square. So here's our magic square, 3x3. Here's a slightly more famous one from a 1514 engraving by Albrecht Dürer. Lots of interest for the mathematician, but I'm particularly interested in this square that appears on there. It's a 4x4 magic square. Every row and every column, and both of the diagonals, add up to 34, which keeps cropping up to me. And to go even better still, he managed to arrange it so that the year in which he made the engraving is at the bottom, 1514. So I think that's pretty cool. Not only has he done a magic square, but he's customised it. So, yeah, let's see if we can do that. Well, here's my first attempt at a magic square. Just stuck the numbers in order. Doesn't work, it's not magic. Because the top row adds up to 10, and the bottom row adds up to something more than 10. Okay, that's easily fixed. Let's swap two of the numbers on the top, two of the numbers on the bottom. The top row and the bottom row both now have the same total, 34. And if we do the same to the two of the items on the middle rows, they'll have the same total as well. We can also do the same with the columns by swapping some of the numbers, and now the columns will also have the same total, and it's a magic square. It's actually slightly quicker to do that if you just start off with the numbers in order, and then you get everything on the diagonals. If a number is on the diagonal, you reflect it to the opposite corner, and that way you can generate a magic square. But I wanted to see if I could customise one. So here's a magic square I created for this evening. I've gone outside the numbers 1 to 16. I've used some slightly bigger ones. And Dürer had the year of his engraving at the bottom. I've got today's date, 13th of December 2017. I also decided, well, why customise the total? Why customise the total? I thought 52 might be nice. So you can check it, every row and every column and both diagonals sums to 52. So, how did that work? Well, it was surprisingly easy, actually. There's the date. How did I do that? Well, here's the normal magic square that we had a moment ago. I want to use our friend the Latin square to customize it. So first of all, let's have a look at this digit here. I don't want 4, I want 13, it's the 13th. So I need to add 9 to this square. Well, if I add 9 to each of these three squares, then I've added 9 to every row and every column. So it would still be magic, and I have my 13 in the corner. So now let's work on the 14. I don't want 14 now, I want 12 because it's December. So I'm going to subtract 2 from each of the yellow squares, which now still magic, and I've got the math. In a similar way, I can add 5 to the blue squares to get up to 20, and I can add 16 to the square in the corner to get up to 17. I've now got a magic square with today's date, so it's fully customised. That's all very well, but that is only going to work if I've got a bit of time to figure it out. How about if I had to do it on the hoof? Okay, so let's see another magic square. But this time I'm going to try and do it against the clock. I'm not going to tell you exactly how this one's done, but I have given hopefully enough of a hint that you might be able to think about how this one works. So this is a custom square, and I'm going to customise the total. So let's have a single digit number. Seven and another one? Nine. Okay, so you've got seven and nine. And sorry, do you want 79 or 97?
I want 97.
You want 97? You would, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to try and do this in 30 seconds or less. Starting now.
Okay.
And 75 is 90, 94, 97, that works. Second column, 77, 78, 84, 97. 81, 86, 95, 97. 79 and 7 is 86, 97. The columns will work. Let's just check the rows. We've got 3, 16, and 81, 97. 75, 81, 86, 97. 77, 81, 90, 97. 79, 81, 82. The rows will become 97! The diagonals as well, 79, 88, 94, 97, 15 and 77, and 5 and 0, also made 97. I think it's why it's not there. Let's take these four numbers in the corner here. 15 and 3 is 18, and 0 and 79. That makes 97 as well. You can check the four numbers in the middle as well. 77, 86, 91, 97, that works as well. These four numbers here are up to 97, we've got these four numbers here adding up to 97, and these four numbers here adding up to 97! And if you check these two there and these two there, they also add up to 97, and that's what I call a magic square! Yeah! Genius or charlatan? I think we all know the answer by now. Yes, but I'm not going to tell you how I did that.
All my £3.
A little play. There's a method of various audience. So to finish off, we're just about ready for break. A few things I want to mention. First of all, maths jam. If you have enjoyed these sorts of tricks and this sort of thing interests you, please come along to maths jam. I'll put up a slide in a minute at the end that tells you about maths jam. We meet on the penultimate Tuesday of the month, obviously. When else? There's a few little postcards at the back. Please do take one, have a look at the sort of puzzle we mess about with. There's a couple of other people here who come to Maths Jam. We sit in the pub, we muck about with magic tricks and numbers and do puzzles. It's lots of fun. You're very welcome to join us. It's at a cow in Parkstone on one Tuesday of every month. And for the last trip, I just really wanted to do something a bit Christmassy. Because this is our last meeting of 2017. So it only seemed fitting that we finish by proving mathematically that Santa Claus exists. So here we have a mathematical proof that Santa exists. I put two statements up on the screen. On the left we have Santa Claus exists. Well, we're going to try and figure out whether or not that is true. On the right we have both of these statements are false. Let's look at that one first. Is that true or not? Well, if it's true, then it's a statement. Is it true or is it not true? Well, look, this one says both of these statements are false, and we know it's not true. Well, if it's not true that both these statements are false, one of them must be true. Now, we've already established that it's not that one. And therefore, logic decrees it has to be that one. And so there you have it, mathematical proof that Santa Claus definitely exists. Yay! Break for a quick interval. Normally now Simon comes up and makes a couple of in-house announcements. I also wanted to pay homage to Magnificent Skeptic, which is our very own Simon Whitlock. He turns up every month before everyone else, shifts about a million chairs and tables, he books the speakers, he liaises with them, he picks them up from the train station and drops them off afterwards. It's as close as it can get to a one-man show. So I wanted to show our appreciation for Simon. I'm also going to put out a bit of a shout out. There are lots of regulars here that I enjoy chatting to every month. If you would like to get involved, we would love a few people to say, yeah, I'll turn up at 7:10 and move some tables and chairs, maybe stay at the end. And for those of you who don't know Simon, he's a lovely guy, so please come up and say hello to him. It's thanks to him, he puts this gig on every month. So I've got a little something to say thank you to Simon. It's a mathematical object, of course, Christmas themed, and it features some of Simon's favourite myths and scenes that some of his most strongly cherished beliefs, such as cats writing Santa Claus lists, reindeer that wear scarves, and of course the nativity scene. Three kings there going to see baby Jesus. So thanks, Simon. Then 5, 6, 9, and 1 something, and you've got a number 432, something like that. I'm already kind of panicking. I'm thinking, well, maybe I could make a 10 and do 43 times 10 and add 2 or something, but a nice check would be to add these three digits up. I've got 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The digit sum is 9. So straight away, no, it's 9 times something. And I see Rachel use that trick quite a lot. So I just made those numbers up because I thought they looked really horrible. But I think my first reaction would be, it's 9 times something. So a quick division by 9, 4 to 36 carries 7, 9, 8. It's 9 times 48 by effectively doing that. But instead of writing the answer up there, I'll put it down there. So I'm thinking, if I can get 48, I can just times it by 9.
3 plus 5 times 2.
3 plus 5 is 8, times 6 is 48, times 9.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think, do you think that would be a sensible way to do it, to look at the digit sum?
Yeah.
I think, I mean, it's very simple just to go, look, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, they add to 9, and so therefore, the rule says it's in the 9 times table. So, all multiples of 9 will have a digit sum of either 9 or 18, or possibly 27, or something higher up than 9 times 10. So it's very easy to see if a given number is a multiple of 9. So yeah, absolutely. I think some of these are useful in countdown.
But that's only going to work when it's, what, 1 time out of 9, except that obviously you've got
works for 3 as well. I mean, there's various other tests for divisibility. Obviously, it's divisible by 10 if it ends in 0. It's easy to see if it's divisible by 2.
Or 5.
Divisible by 3, you can use that trick. A number's divisible by 4 if the last two digits are divisible by 4. So if I had like 9,252, I know that's divisible by 4 because the last two digits are. There's test for divisibility.
It's also divisible by 9.
Sorry?
It's also divisible by 9.
There you go. So we'll go along counting them up. I can ignore that 9 and because we've already got 9. Yeah, up to 9 as well. So the whole thing's going to add up to a multiple of 9. So it's 9 times something. There's a test for. Do you know the test for divisibility by 11?
At something even minus something else.
Yeah, I think you go. I can't quite remember, I was playing with it the other day, but it's something like 7, 2, 5, so let's see if that is. You
you start with that, you subtract that, and add that, and subtract that. And is it, if you get zero, then it's divisible by 11?
Four multiple of 11.
Yeah, yeah. So we've got 7, take 2 is 5, plus 5 is 10, take 3 is 7, so it's not divisible by 11. Anyway. So, I did their useful in these tricks, but I'd love to find out Rachel's favourite tricks to count them.
I would as well.
Shall I rephrase that? Thank you.
Why did the disciples catch 153 fish?
153 fish?
Yeah.
I give up. Why didn't the disciples catch
it? I can't remember. I was hoping it would... No. Well, I think... Well, you might like to look into this, because I think 153 is a Pythagorean magical number. And you can do all sorts of things.
I did read recently about the number 666.
Yeah.
Which, do you know about this? It's, they've recently found an older biblical translation, the previous oldest one. And it turns out it was a mistranslation. It's the number of the beast is actually, is it 668?
Yeah.
Oh, is it?
And all these years, I've been trying to say, and I've never come when I call it, and I've been using the wrong number. So, no, I don't know about that.
I think it's something to do with a rhomboid shape, but I can't remember the exact details.
I have some very expert mathematicians over here.
Lena's saying it never happens, you know, so. Well, no, it never happens.
Hey, Bobby, I've often wondered this, and I'm really sorry I missed this bit, but you know what happens out when you pick the number 42 as the answer to the meaning quite
clearly? 42? The answer
to the meaning.
Yes, it's 6 months, sir.
Does anyone know of any special significance for the number 42?
10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10.
Yes, it is, because a friend of ours got married on the 10th of October 2010, presumably because he thought it would be easy to remember his wedding anniversary. And it did come up in the best man speech that the groom was a avid Douglas Adams fan, and that perhaps the reason he'd chosen to get married on that date is because it's 42. It's binary for 42. So there you go. It does have a special significance. Yes. It's 10, 10, 10.
You want me to ask my question about Latin squares?
About the Latin squares?
Yes.
I think we should. Yeah, so Michael came up on the interval and was explaining that when you worked something with fertilizers?
Yes, so I worked for Fisons as a chemist. And if you wanted to test the efficacy of a fertilizer, you had to use Latin squares in the field. You couldn't just divide it down the middle. You had to do random squares in the field.
Yeah, which is exactly what we had up there. Yeah. So if you're testing 4 different fertilizers, you don't just put fertilizer 1 there, 2 there, 3 there, 4 there. You mix them all around in a Latin square.
Same applies in your garden. If you want to test the fertilizer in your lawn, you need to use Latin squares.
So a nice little puzzle you can do is set up a 5x5 grid and try and create a Latin square and see if you can move the 5 treatments around so that every treatment is represented once in every row and once in every column. It's quite a fun puzzle. So, yeah, just something to think about. You've got 5 treatments. Where would you put the 5 treatments so that one corner or row or column isn't overrepresented compared to all the others? And then once you've figured that out, you might be able to use that to customize your own 5x5 magic squares. The 5x5 magic square is very easy to do, because you start with 1, and then you keep going in a sort of northeasterly direction. That unfortunately has gone off the grid, so I'm going to re-emerge there. So it's going to be 1, 2, 3, well, I'm going to go off there, so I'm going to re-emerge here. It's like in those space invader games where you go off one side of the screen and re-emerge on the other side. So heading that way, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm now back to the beginning.
I can't go northwest, northeast, so I'll go down. So I then go 6, 7, 8, it's going to re-emerge there, 9, 10, then 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. And then you have a 5x5 square, everything adds up to 65. And if you want to customize it, maybe you've got five numbers you want to go down the bottom. If you can figure out the Latin square, you can start adjusting, say, this number and choose four others so that every row and every column is affected. I quite often do magic squares like that with people's birthday cards, because it's nice to sort of give them a magic square that adds up to their age. Have a play with them, Nicola.
I'm not sure about that.
John?
I've seen savants or savants and savants. Do things like dates, so they're given a date and they tell you what day of the week it was, you know, either ahead or behind. Can you do that?
The question is, can I say what dates or what day of the week the 3rd of January 1964 was? No, I can't, but it is in this book by Arthur Benjamin. And he has special codes for the day of the week and codes for the month of the year. And then you have to memorise a load of codes for the years. We were talking about this in the break, actually, with a couple of people. I'm not so keen on it, because if someone says, oh, like, what day was I born on? And I say, what was your date of birth? And I come back with, you were born on a Thursday. I don't really think that's very impressive for everyone else watching. And also, how does the guy, or the person really know they were born on a Thursday? Maybe they always thought they were born on a Thursday, but it turns out they're born on a Wednesday. And so if you do the trick on it, it's going to completely fall flat. There's an algorithm, there's a set of steps you follow, and it'll tell you the day of the week. I've not learned many of these tricks, to be honest, because they're too hard, but I love reading about them.
I think there's a big difference between tricks like that, you know, and the savants thing you're talking about, because they just know. They don't use tricks, do they?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's a huge...
I suspect they think about numbers very differently to the way
it
normally.
Yeah. But I would imagine that for them, it just comes into their head rather than actually trying to work.
You see, I've seen documentaries with people who are blessed or cursed, depending on your point of view, with these phenomenal memories. And if you say, what were you doing on the 23rd of July, 1984? They say, oh, yeah, I remember that was a Tuesday, and it was raining, and I was watching this thing on TV. And I would think that's a curse rather than a blessing to have all this useless information cluttering up your brain.
I agree.
But yeah, there are savants who just know it, but there are also people who have devoted a lot of time and energy to working out methods of working out the day of the week. Yeah, absolutely, it's a big difference. Not something I've explored. I've got the book, I've read it, but I've not learned it. I only like easy tricks.
You have to keep your brain doing other calculations, don't you? You don't want to fill it out with useless information.
Yeah. Useful all the time,
isn't it? The trivia experts you see on the telly, they must just sit there and just memorise facts day in and day out, useless facts. I don't know, it's nice to use your brain, stay off dementia and all that.
Like, are they magic squares have any providing further insight within maths or outside of it?
So, yeah, do magic squares provide any further insights in maths? I don't know, that's a sort of applied mathematician's question, because I guess there's two ways of looking at maths. One person might say, oh, okay, well, that's all very well, but when is that ever going to be useful for anything? And then that would be like an applied mathematician. But a pure mathematician might turn around and say, why does there have to be a point to it? You know, why can't you just appreciate it for its beauty?
So I guess most of us are somewhere in the middle. I would say that mathematical diversions like magic squares have a habit of finding applications further on down the line. And there's often quite a big lag between some new maths being discovered and an application being found for it. But certainly a lot of the number theory, which is just a theory of the whole numbers, and what happens if you add them and multiply them, that was studied for thousands of years, and then suddenly it gets to the 21st century, or the 20th century, and people say, that modular arithmetic, that's exactly what I need for my data encryption on the internet. And so, yeah, I think maths has a habit of finding applications somewhere. Personally, I just like to enjoy it for its recreation. But the magic square, when it comes to uses of magic squares, certainly Latin squares have their uses, like we heard in agriculture and chemistry. But I'm not aware of any specific application of a magic square, other than for entertainment purposes, of course.
Why is it called a Latin square? Where was it for? Is that where it was first observed in some documents?
I have no idea why it's called a Latin square. We don't know why it's called a Latin square.
Isn't there some inscription, five letters arranged in?
Yes, with a mystic Christian meaning, possibly.
Yeah.
A repo.
This sounds like the orbits of the planets. Is it?
No, it's a.
You're right, it's a repo. Sort
of the letters that read the same.
Perhaps it's due to Latin numbers.
Yes.
Latin numbers?
But it isn't, yes. Because Latin numbers would be Roman numbers, and it's not. Roman numbers is not what you're working with. You're working with Arabic numbers.
Roman numbers, I love Roman numbers, because they're just so daft.
They're not.
Because you go one, and then you go two, and then you go three, and then you go four, and then eventually someone said, no, scrap it, I'll invent a new one. V for five, because it's five fingers, that's what I want to do. And then four, you just put one in front of them, and that's about it. But try doing it. I mean, try doing that. The Romans, for all their talents, they're crap at maths. They were great at invading people and building roads, but they weren't much good at maths.
You used to have a question to your roads.
Maybe they couldn't do the angles.
Yeah. No, they have an abacus for doing their numbers.
I don't know, it's got to be better than you to those. I mean, let's have the number. 888, for instance. Right. In Roman numerals, that's D, C, 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 L, X, 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 V, 111. that's just pants. They're pretty melted for
the thing. Romans, obviously, they called it the Greeks into their empire, and the Greeks were doing maths a long time. What did the Greeks use before Roman?
That's a good question.
Did they have a Greek numbering system that was also based on the Indian number system?
By Colin's book, Greek alphabet
was used for the numbers.
Yeah. So I've been through that great history of maths book, and according to the chapter on Hindu numerals, they used to use base 60. So we count base 10 because when you get to 10 you start a new column. But it hasn't always been that way, and some of the ancients used to use base 60.
26 for Greece, if my memory is right.
26 for Greece. There's a bizarre number.
Oh, that's the number that's in the Greek alphabet.
But they wouldn't have used it. Page 26
accounts. Actually, I'm a Greek alphabet.
Well, prior to 1972, we used base 12.
Which is sure to be hard. I learned it as a sort of, I learned the mentalist sort of rhyme, and it was definitely four letters for each. And the alphabet together with the text, something to eat, each other,
And it's really beautiful, and a litre of water is exactly a kilogram, and every 10 to 100. But I do love the strange mysteries of the imperial system. What is it, 1,760 yards in a mile? I think.
Yeah.
It's
not more practical, I think.
Multiple 11. Oh, is it a multiple 11? Let's have a look. 1,760. Okay, so we'll start with that one. We'll subtract that's minus 6. We'll add that at 0, we'll subtract that, it is, it's a multiple of 11! That's why there's 1,760 yards in the mile.
It's very good for your maths if you use old systems, because you're not just using stupid numbers, you're actually thinking.
I've heard this argument before. So this is the argument that we should have stuck with pre-decimal period, because it made us think. Why should we make it really easy to use? We should make it difficult, because then people have to use their brains to work it out. I don't think the argument stands up.
It worked for English farmers for hundreds of years, didn't it?
Anyway,
there is a purpose for Roman numbers. If you live at a house that's under 100, number 100, because if you're marking out your weenie business, a lot cheaper to put your numbers. By purpose of numbers, so Roman numerals do have a purpose.
For marking your weenie business. But if you need number 88, right, you need LXXXV11. That would cost me £7.
Down the pound shop, you can get one. Down the pound shop, a single figure will cost you £1, and it costs you a lot more.
Would the Romans have used an abacus?
Yes. That seems to... If you get on paper, it seems crazy to do maths with Roman numerals, but it might be a lot easier with abacus, because you have different ones for L and X.
This is the sort of thing we did down at the Math Academy, the penultimate Tuesday of the month. I spent a very enjoyable evening one time trying to figure out what the rule would be for sort of for multiplying numbers or something. We did find some rules, but it didn't really work very well, to be honest. I think, yeah, probably an abacus is the way to go rather than Roman numerals.
It probably fits. I mean, you could look at a number and easily set it up on an abacus. Right. One L, three X's, it would be dead easy.
Then the abacus falls apart where you've got things like 4, which is one less than 5, and 6, which is one more than 5. And it's the same with, like, when you get to 90 something or 900 something, you say it's.
Yeah, it's a slightly different pattern there. Yeah. It kind of has place value, but it kind of doesn't. Now, I do love the thing, one of our first speakers, I forget who it was, pointed out that on a watch, if you have Roman numerals, the number 4 is almost always like that instead of like that, which I think is great. Yeah, it was Chris French, yeah, he was great. But I love the variety. digits that people have on their watches. Some people have just a 12 and a 6 and a 3 and a 9. Some people have Roman numerals. Some people have no numbers at all. Personally, I have all the numbers because I want to see what the time is.
I was just looking on my phone, as one does, and the Egyptians seem to have been considerably ahead of the Romans, because they used something that looks very much like base 10.
Good for them.
Yeah.
I didn't know you
were that dumb. Base 10 makes sense to me, because we've got 10 fingers.
Yes.
So if you're Bart Simpson, they have 8 fingers, so you'd use base 8 if you were in Springfield. Because that way you can count on your fingers.
If we have a decimal system, we are 10, and then there's 11 and 12. Why don't we go straight into T's?
Ah, well, the Welsh, you see, they've got the sorted. So the question is, why do we go 11, 12, 13? Why not 13, 14, and why not 15? And yeah, I think that's a really good question, because my daughter's 13 now, and I can still remember when she was learning to count. And the 1 to 10 is pretty easy. But then it gets really confusing in the teens. Once you got to 20, that's easy. You can count up to 100. God, but the teens are really weird. So the Welsh have got it right. They count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then it goes 1, 10, 2, 10, 3, 10, 4, 10, 5, 10, 6, 10, 7, 10, 8, 10, 9, 10. 2 tens.
Mm.
2 tens 1, 2 tens 2, 2 tens 3. Just proceeds like that. It all makes perfect sense. Then you've got the French, of course. You go
6, 12, 20.
Yeah, I think 12 is 2, 10. Or maybe it's 10, 2.
This is
20, 2 tens.
Where's the England? It's just pronounced it. It's 15, it's 5 tens.
Yeah, but why is it pronounced different? Why don't we just say
it's lazy and it's slower? It's not as bad as the French, it's still in the last letter.
Yeah, but the French have got it completely mad, because it goes 57, 58, 59, oh no, it goes 60, and then 61, 62, etc. And then off to 69, it goes 60-10. And then 70s. 71, 72, 72s. And then they go up to 80. And then 90 is 80-10.
80 is
catching up. Catching up, yeah, 420s.
Yeah, so you're already doing a sum, just say 80.
Yeah. I think Welsh.
I've got a question for you. You know, earlier you were talking about the number of Satan, which was 666, and then you decided it was 668, I think. Not you decided, but you corrected it. Do you know the number for Jesus?
I do know that the Bible actually were ahead of their time, because they do know what pi, you know this obviously. In the Bible there is a passage where they talk about pi.
Yeah, but you're avoiding the question.
It does actually say the Bible pi is 3. Yeah. He says there's a passage where they get the circumference of a circle and divide it by the diameter, and they said, it says the circumference is 3 times the diameter.
They got it wrong.
I've not answered your own question.
No. Well, you actually had it on the board earlier.
The number of Jesus?
Yeah.
It's either 7 or 11.
No, it was 888.
Really?
Yeah, and that was really spooky that you put that number up.
Oh, yeah. I didn't put a little fish sign next to it.
No, you didn't.
Why is 888?
Well, it goes back to what Michael was saying, that it's based on the Greek letters, and I think if you take the letters of Jesus in Greek, it comes to 888. Look at that. Spooky. So I'm just wondering why you chose that number earlier.
Well, obviously, salvation is mine. Thank you.
Got him out of the hole.
You have the number 9 times table. That's yes. The magic props.
Yes.
In our base 10 accountant.
Yes.
Is it the true base accountant system? The base minus 1 times table will have the same.
I believe that is the case, yeah. So if you live in Cartoon Land, they normally draw cartoon characters with four things on a hand instead of five, because or else it just looks too messy. So in The Simpsons, for instance, they've all got eight fingers instead of ten. So their digit sum, they count in base eight, then the seven times table would have that digit sum property.
Yeah, but I think the ruler is the same. That's a good guide. For instance, 99, after 18, I think you have to keep going. Get it,
Yeah.
So it's the digital root rather than the digital sum. So for instance, 99, and the sum of those digits is 18 rather than 9. So you have to get down to single numbers.
Right, so this number here, for instance, we want to know if it's divisible by 9. So we just add them all up, 5 and 7 is 12, 15, 18. So the digit sum is 18. You can then either do the digit sum again to get 9, or you can just say, well, that's a multiple of 9, therefore that's a multiple. If that's what you're saying. But did you know the time to table trick for the 9 times 7 where you fold the fingers down?
Yeah.
Oh, this is great. So suppose I want 9 times 4, we count 1, 2, 3, 4, and we fold the fourth finger down. So 9 times 4 is 36, because there's 3 fingers on this side and 6 fingers on that side. Mm-hmm. So a lot of school children will be writing away and they'll go like that, and then carry on writing. But it also works for the 99 times table. But instead of 10 fingers, you need 100 fingers. I really don't think we should do this, but if you get 10 people in a row with their fingers like this, okay, suppose you want 99 times by 43, you count along 43 fingers and fold that one down, and you see how many fingers you've got on that side and on that side, and that'll give you the answer.
That's why centipedes are so good at maths.
I guess I didn't know centipedes.
Well, no, I didn't.
I'm sure you know the digits.
Yeah.
I love stuff like that. Like, do you know the thing about the months of the year? If you put your hands like that, then if it's a raised knuckle, it's got 31 days, and if it's a sunken knuckle, it doesn't have 31 days. So January, February, March, April, May has 31, June doesn't, July has 31. And then we skip to the other hand, so August has 31 days. And you can figure out which months have 31 days and which don't. Which strikes me as a lot easier than working out what day of the week it was.
Or reciting the poem wrongly. Well, there's a poem that has a mnemonic for it. Would you mind if I showed any of the tricks with your hands?
Yeah, let's do it. Oh!
Well, I want to show you something that is used in foreign schools. Not that I've heard of it being used in this country, but it's a digital computer. In other words, you're going to use your hands. And we assume now we're a teacher, and we've children know that up to their 5 times table. And we want to help them do the table, any pair of digits from 5 to 10, or in practice 6 to 9. Then you can use this little trick to work out what the answer is. So let's do the dreaded 7 times 8. And I'd say, oh, do it. Come on, left hand's out. 5. Bend your thumb over. 6. Bend your other fixed finger. 7. Now we do it with the 8. 5, 6, 7, 8. Add the bent fingers together. Multiply by 10. So now 50.
I've lost you.
And it works for all those digits from 5 to 10. Not magic. No, it's not magic. I could put it out of grey. It would be terribly boring. But it works. That's right.
Can you do 7 9s?
Huh?
So if it was 7 9s, you go 5, 6, 7.
Yes.
And 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
That's right.
All right, so I'll put these together.
Yes.
So I've got 2 and 4.
Yeah, that's 6.
60.
60, yes.
And then
1 3. One times 3.
One times 3.
One times 3.
So you add the bent ones, and you multiply the straight ones.
So you add the bent ones and multiply by 10.
Yeah, add the bent ones and stick it in the 10s column.
That's right. And then you multiply the straight fingers.
Interesting.
I use a little trick for kiddies. So anyway, give it a bit of advice to your children or your grandchildren or your great grandchildren.
If I've got ten fingers and I can count down 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, it's 11. I seem to have 11 fingers.
Were you counting up or counting down?
Both.
You're counting how many you've got, but how many haven't you got? Uh-oh, here comes trouble.
No, don't worry, this is an easy, this is an easy question for you. What does the Bournemouth jester do?
What does the Bournemouth jester do? So, my friend Jonathan, up in Salisbury, created the Guild of Jesters some years ago, and the idea was that every major town or city should have a jester to represent it. So it was a bit of fun, really, and the Guild of Jesters would meet several times a year and bestow a jesterhood on a particular jester, and if you lived in, say, Basingstoke, and the position was open, you could apply to the Guild to become the jester of Basingstoke. And the criteria were you had to have a jerkin, which is a jester costume, and it had to include cap and bells. You had to be multi-skilled, and you had to have the ability to hold an audience's attention for something like 10 minutes. So to prove this, all the jesters would convene on, say, Basingstoke, turn up in force to the town centre, gather a crowd, and then send this jester out to prove that he or she could keep the crowd entertained for 10 minutes, after which there would be some sort of ceremony and they would be now pronounced, you are now the official jester of Basingstoke. And the press would be invited, of course, and the town hall would get contacted, and often the mayor would come down and oversee it, and it was, yeah, all very good fun, and I think we had about 20 jesters of various places, and no one's challenged me for it yet, because back in the day I was a juggler before a magician, and I went around with my juggling and unicycling act and so forth, and I became jester Bournemouth, but no one's challenged me for the position, so I guess it's still mine.
And do you have any specific duties to perform?
That would have to be a no, but we're definitely encouraged to turn up to future Guild of Jester moves to bestow a jesterhood on the next person.
Yes. Have you got a photograph of your kit?
No, I don't think I do. I might be able to stick one up on the screen.
If somebody challenges you, you have a jest off.
Yes. Well, there was a guy called Jamie Paul who sort of said, well, I should be. And it was mooted that perhaps we should have a jest off. But it never quite happened. But yeah, absolutely. That's what was had to happen. No, this is going to take way too long. So, yeah. If you Google Barney Bay, you'll come up with a very pretty picture of me in my jest off.
Isn't that yours on the third thing down?
Sorry?
The car.
Oh yeah, there you go. So there's where we meet for maths jam. So bring a puzzle. If you don't have one, we'll give you one. And have a pint and muck about with some numbers and shapes for it.
It's really a test to see whether you know what the word penultimate means.
You can sign up to the email list as well, and then you actually get a reward. But I think one of my very favourite maths tricks that comes up from time to time. I just love this one, and if you know it, then you know it. And if you don't, I've never seen anyone figure this out unless they happen to know it. But the idea is you've got to figure out what comes next in this sequence. Some people know this one. It's so interesting. It's what comes next. And a few people are nodding, they know this one. It looks like a just bizarre set of hieroglyphs. But
it does make sense. If I cover up half of the hoof, then you should be able to see the number one. And then it's always gone, but that's number five. So the next symbol would have to be that one. So yeah, I love silly things like that. If you turn up to Math Jam, I'll be mucking about with that in the corner. And there'll be some heavyweight mathematicians doing proper stuff in another corner.
I'm sure some people maybe don't know this one. The world can be divided into 10. Those are thinking binary and those are
yeah. And Simon.
It's a visual joke to have pencil here.
And there is a thinking joke.
Oh, yeah, we'll have some more jokes in a minute, maybe.
Should we have any recommendations of maths related books or your favourite maths related books?
Oh, absolutely, favourite maths related books. Okay, so who was here for our inaugural meet in, was it March 2014?
Yeah, yeah. Simon Singh.
Joy's there, brilliant. So we had Simon Singh, who is very active in the sceptics movement, and he was talking. Was he doing the Simpsons?
It was the half-man,
Simon Singh is a great maths author. His book, Fermat's Last Theorem, is very good. The Code book is very good. I also recommend Cracking Mathematics by our very own Colin Beveridge. He's given a couple of talks here. There have been some really, really dull history of maths books over the years, which is a shame because there's so many great characters, like the guy who got drowned at sea for discovering irrational numbers, and this is sort of what I always get it wrong. And then there's Galois, who was run through with a sword, a duel over a woman, and that was the end of him. And Archimedes in the bathtub with the water. Displaced in the prison. But there's so many great stories in maths, and so I recommend that one, Cracking Mathematics. Anything by Simon Singh is very good.
Was Ian Stewart? Hofstadter.
What's that? Hofstadter? Oh, Douglas Hofstadter. Have you read it? I got that a third of the way through it, and then it started getting better. It's horrible. So Douglas Hofstadter, Gogol Escher Bach, it's about mathematical paradoxes, such as the proof of the existence of Santa Claus. That sort of thing is talked about in very, very great length and illustrated with some sort of parables. So it's almost comparable to the Bible, I think, certainly in length and style. I don't know, I stopped halfway through that one.
Honest Joe or Charlatan?
Sorry?
Honest Joe or Charlatan?
Hofstadter? Hofstadter?
Yes.
Oh, Honest Joe, just I wish you'd cut to the chase.
Yes.
That's another joke.
Joe or Charlatan, you're applying it to on off thing. It's a grey area between concepts.
Absolutely. And, I'm really fascinated by David Blaine's endurance stunts, because he started off as a magician, and then he started doing all this endurance stuff. And I just don't know how much of that I believe. Like the one where he was locked in a perspex box, suspended over the River Thames for 40 days. All he had was water to drink. But I mean, there's been a scientific paper written about the refeeding process, because you have to, after fasting for so long, you have to reintroduce food quite gradually. And I have no doubt that he did spend many hours in that box. Did they somehow sneak some food in or swap him for a David Blaine lookalike? I don't know. What do you think?
Hadn't they messed out of some sort of pasta or something or other that at night time he could remember? I don't know. Did they have a light on at night?
I heard a rumour about in the dead of night at 3 a.m. or something, they'd send some window cleaners up to clean the perspex, and it's alleged that perhaps a switch went on at that time.
They came just from the outside.
Yeah. I don't know. And the holding your breath for 17 minutes, that one really bugs me. doesn't seem right.
$3 on the breath for 4 minutes. It's more than that.
It's more than that.
It's nowhere near 7 minutes.
When I hold it for like 4 minutes, but while dying, while exercising as well. I don't know.
Yes,
but yeah, there are definitely charlatans out there, and there are definitely honest Joes who do really tough magic tricks. I didn't do anything particularly difficult tonight. I'm a charlatan. Yeah.
So, stop. Right, a big round of applause.